talking about Swami, I mean, I was talking of how the building blocks of faith for me was actually watching him, being with him, putting forth this little little tests, if you will, to does he really read my mind? Does he, you know? So I wanted to know firsthand, would he read? Does he know what am I thinking? Does he know what's going on? And I would do that not out of defiance, but out of an intense yearning. And there was a sense of a naivety in Swami, a sense of childishness, you know. It wasn't as if he was, I don't know if he was pulling a leg or not, but it didn't seem that time. That time you were like, oh my gosh, what do I do? Where do I stand with this person? If I do this, it goes wrong. If I do this, it is wrong. So where do I stand? He kept us on our toes. That made us really watch every single action of ours, every single word of ours, every single thought of ours. We were like alert. And I guess that was true training of living in the moment. Honestly, it was, you couldn't let go even for a second. He's a phenomenon that I have never been able to understand.
An enigma. You can't figure him out.
Enigma, a phenomenon, a being, if you will, not a human person. I would definitely say he is not human as you and I are. As we see things and feel things and listen to things, he is not the same. He's not like you and me. He tries to be like you and me. He tries to talk like you and me. He tries to behave like you and me, but he is not. There was a room just above the interview room, which is pretty much the same size as the interview room. Mm-hmm. And there was one chair. And and the rest of the room was practically empty.
Did he have books or telephones or magazines?
No. It just letters most of the time.
I mean, these aren't
there weren't any books that he would sit down and read. I would never seen him read.
How about newspapers?
Newspapers would come and it would lie on his desk.
How about television?
No, there was no television.
Radio.
There was no television, no radio. Now, when I deal with youngsters in the young adults, and I talk to them about Swami, I'm on my toes because I don't know what questions they're going to come up with. And I was like that when I went to Swami. Mm-hmm. And so for me to accept him, I want to tell people, hey, listen, if I can do it, you could do it. Because I actually saw a person in action who defies normal human logic. A relationship with a guru, a master and a disciple is something so unique. I didn't realize the uniqueness of it till the separation was brought about. And reminded of a quote, a beautiful quote, which says, separation diminishes lesser affections and increases greater ones. The most painful was when I actually saw the samadhi taking place on the third day, and suddenly the fact that he was no more hit you. But that's why I said it took me those 3 days where we cried shamelessly. I just let go. I didn't stop myself. Ever since Swami passing away, it's like, what am I doing with my life now?
Dr. Sundar Iyer spent 15 and a half years living in Sai Baba's Indian ashram, Prashanti Nilayam, receiving his bachelor's, master's, and PhD degrees, and then teaching for 2 years at Sai Baba's university. In the early 1980s, Sundar Iyer spent 2 years serving as Sai Baba's personal household attendant. His stories are many, as are his direct experiences with Sai Baba.
जब से देखी है तेरी निगाहें या खुदा मैं तो तेरा हो गया.
This complete song sung by Sundar will be presented in its entirety at the end of this video. This is one of several Sojourn's videos detailing Sundar Iyer's experiences with Sai Baba. They can most easily be found by date. Welcome to Sojourns. This interview was recorded in Elyria, Ohio on June 18, 2011.
Sundar, thanks a whole lot for one more opportunity to probe your many, many years being a follower of Sai Baba, and especially the years when you were there working side by side with him as an attendant. And I guess I want to begin by where we left off when we once talked about why you purposely don't choose to refer to Bhagavan Sri Sathya Sai Baba as God. You have an explanation for it that I didn't ask for the last time. What is it?
Okay. First of all, thank you again for having me. It's always a pleasure and a great honor to talk about my teacher and my master. And I've often been asked this when I speak at retreats or in other places, why don't you say he is God? And the only reason why I don't is because, very simply put, I don't know what God means. To say Baba is God or not God would imply that the person who's saying it knows what this God is all about. If you give me a fruit and say, hey Sundar, here's an apple, and what you're holding is an orange, I would turn around and say, hey Ted, that's not an apple, that's an orange. And the reason I can say that's not an apple is because I've tasted an apple. I know what an apple looks like. And I know that this is an apple or not an apple. To claim Sai Baba as God or not God both implies that I know what God is or what it means. I don't. I'm still in that exciting journey of discovering what this all means. And I think the irony of the fact is I've come now to believe that the day I feel and experience and understand what God means, I would still not say he's God, because at that point I would be silent anyway.
Well, you were in an unmistakable position to learn more about God, as Baba says he is, and he says the same thing about Sundar and Jody and Maya and Ted.
Yes.
Then most anyone else on the face of the earth, has probably only been a handful of people to have such close proximity as you had for such a long period of time. And it's the chief criticism people bring to me about why I didn't follow up with such a golden opportunity when I had you before this camera talking about this. So let's probe that in the most meaningful, productive ways we can.
Yes.
Tell us more about that.
You know, even though I don't say he is God, I definitely want to say something. He's a phenomenon that I have never been able to understand.
An enigma. You can't figure him out.
Enigma, a phenomenon, a being, if you will, not a human person. I would definitely say he is not human as you and I are. As we see things and feel things and listen to things, he is not the same. He's not like you and me. He tries to be like you and me. He tries to talk like you and me. He tries to behave like you and me, but he is not. And I have so many instances, and I can share with you two or three of those instances which I saw. You know, it's a one-on-one first-hand experience, and I think it's very important for us to, as contemporaries of this this incarnation, if you will, to know the idiosyncrasies of a master. You know, Yogananda writes in his book the idiosyncrasies of his master, and I often wondered what masters and what kind of idiosyncrasies that they have. And after having lived with Swami, I knew that this is so true, because these people perceiving the world at from a completely different level, and I don't know what that level is. And I'm sure in our own small insignificant way, we have had those glimpses which lifts our spirits and minds so high, and we call that bliss, or we call that a great mood, we call that a peak experience or a spiritual experience. But for somebody to live in that 24/7, what an amazing thing that would have been, or that would be. So, and I firmly believe I saw Baba living in that kind of a plane all the time. And like I said,
you did not see many or any deviations from that plane.
I rarely saw any deviations from that plane. That's why I said he tried to be like us. He would try to, you know, speak to you and ask you your name, but you knew it right through that he knew exactly what he was talking about and why he was, you know.
And let me follow up one bit, because I think it might have been somebody we know from Pasadena, California, who has spent 35 years with him, who shared this story that once he was riding with Baba in a car, and there was a student, and there was a villager, and there was a head of a corporation in the mm-hmm. front seat, and there was Baba, and there was this fellow, a longtime devotee. And Baba had a way of reflecting back to each individual, if my memory serves me correctly, himself, as exactly that person would expect Baba to be to him. In other words, he's almost multidimensional depending on who he's talking to.
He is. Like I was mentioning in the last interview about the Buddhist monks, where he spoke to me and I heard was Telugu, and what they heard was a completely different language. And both of us got to hear about what he had said about the Kundalini and yoga. That was a brilliant exposition. And so he does come to each one of us separately, and we would be 15-20 students sitting around him, but each of us would take home a completely different message, a completely different Swami. Just to highlight that particular point, and then I'll highlight some of these quirks of Swami. Highlight that point. We would all be sitting in the bhajan hall, and there would be students next to me who would, you know, twist and turn when it is like 3 hours or 2 hours of sitting, because we are all cramped for darshan. But when it came to me, I don't know whether Swami knew I was learning yoga or whatever. Even if I would move like this, he would stare at me. He would look like as if so disappointed with me. And for some time, initially that would hurt me. I would say, look at this guy. He's sitting like this. And he's looking at Swami like this. And why can't I be a little more, you know, my back was hurting and my knees were hurting. But even if I would shift like this a little bit, he would stare, you know, he would give a very disapproving look. So even though there were 15-20 of us, he would deal with each of us individually. He would never generalize, never ever generalize. He would be very particular about who sits on this side of him, who would sit on this side of him. And if for some reason something didn't turn out, he would finish the interview in 5 minutes and walk away, and we would know something went wrong. So he would want everything the way he wants it.
Why would he be that strict?
That's one of the quirks of him. I mean, that's one of the things which we never understood. He would be so upset if somebody whom he didn't want sitting on the left side instead of the right side.
Why would he look at him?
He would indicate to that boy. I mean, there would be many instances where I sat in the wrong place and I got such a stare that I would quietly move to the right place. And then he would find him relaxed. But if I didn't get the message, I would upset him so much that he would get up and even walk away.
And what does that mean to you?
Nothing. Those are the kind of times where you sit down and wonder, what does this mean? I mean, what is wrong if I sit on this side of his chair or that side of his chair? Why is he so particular? But you, over a period of time, you just came to respect his and go with his flow, the flow of his energy, because you begin to respect what he wishes, and you knew there was a blessing in every single thing that he did.
But a decade
that came gradually.
But a decade later, looking back over this peculiar history now, have you put it together any better in your mind as to what he was trying to accomplish?
No, and that's one of the reasons I said he's still a phenomenon. I wouldn't, and the day I would be able to piece it together, I wouldn't be able to talk, I'm sure, because, I mean, I guess the truly wise man is silent, and as long as we are here talking, we know that we are ignorant, trying to grasp something which is way beyond our grasp. Talking about Swami, I mean, I was talking of how the building blocks of faith for me was actually watching him, being with him, putting forth these little little tests, if you will, to does he really read my mind? Does he, you know, there were some of these months before I got into his room, which was a whole different thing, and I'll come to that in a little bit, was when I was just a student like anybody else, and I was interested in Swami. Now I started becoming curious about his metaphysical abilities, where, you know, you're in Puttaparthi, you're in ashram, and people tell you stories which are phenomenal in nature. I mean, things which you as a youngster would think, there's no way this can be true, because if it's true, then my whole life is going to be changed if I'm going to accept it. And for me, accepting that was a big thing. I wanted to know firsthand, does he know what am I thinking? Does he know what's going on? And I would do that not out of defiance, but out of an intense yearning. And always I said, you know what, I really want this faith, Swami. So give it to me and bless me with it. I really want to know you. I want to understand you. And I think there's a difference between that and saying, hey, okay, if you can read my mind, can you do this? You know, then he probably would have just ignored me. So it wasn't out of a defiant attitude. It was more of an attitude of, I'm willing to learn, but I need that faith. I need that. So simple things like, I remember once, there was this lady who would sing a long bhajan. In those days, you had men and women singing in the bhajan hall. And every time she would start singing, Baba would make a big face, because it's a very long bhajan. And Baba has 20-25 minutes from 6 to 6:25, he would sit. So once she starts singing this, she would start extremely slow and then drag the bhajan, because it's her chance to sing in front of Baba, and she would take as long as... So it would take at least 4 to 5 minutes for one bhajan. And Baba would like, you know, fast, Namasmarana type mm-hmm. bhajans, where you just chant God's name and move on and chant different God's names. So he's looking, because he often says, I'm sitting on the chair looking at devotees, you're looking at me, so you don't know what's going on out there. So anyway, when this lady would start, every time Baba would make a face like this, look at her, smile sheepishly, but he would allow her to finish it too, I mean, because mm-hmm. of his immense love for her. So one day this lady started, and I'm thinking in my mind, okay Baba, if you know what's going on in my mind, and I always wanted to put something out of the ordinary challenges to Baba, if you will, so that I know it was meant for me. I said, Baba, if you can really read my mind, just to prove to me once, make this lady sing this bhajan three times. You know, the bhajans are sung twice, once yes. in a normal speed, and then the mm-hmm. second time you go faster. So Baba would hardly let her finish the faster type, because by then it's 5 minutes. So I'm like, now I'm saying, can you make this go three times today? Because there's no way you would have ever done it, and you've never done it so far. So if you do that for me, I know that there's something going on between you and me. And this is just one youngster in that crowd, believe me. And I said, please, please for me. And she started, and Swami made a face, looked out there, and started doing the talam. And the second time went, and then to my surprise, he went the third speed, and then looked at me saying, just for you, I'm doing this, and only once.
So you really did have him answer.
So yes, that was the first time I said, wow, he did it. And I was so, he gave me a sheepish grin saying, I'm just doing this for you. There was another time he was going out he was giving darshan, and I would sit with the boys here. And these are all the days before I got to know him physically, in that sense of as a one-on-one thing. Mm-hmm. I was just one among the many students. And so I always thought he never knew who I was. So he's among the devotees giving darshan, and he comes, walks over from the lady side to the gent side. And I'm looking at Swami there, I'm thinking, there is no possible way he can be thinking of me now, right? So I'm looking at him, and as he's passing by, and I look at Swami, I say, Swami, if you are thinking of me, show me a sign right now. Please, show me a sign right now. And in a matter of second, he turned around, looked at me, and called me like this. He's standing there, he's calling me, he did like this. My knees froze. I was so scared, because it happened all in a couple of seconds.
And
a flashing thought.
It was you he was pointing.
Yeah, it was just about probably 30 feet. So you mm-hmm. knew he was looking at you across the sand. And he said like this. And I just went, because I didn't know why he's calling me out of the darshan line. And it's different when he stands in the interview room and calls you in. Mm-hmm. But he's standing out there and pulling you out. I thought, I'm done for. So I'm going to him and thinking, oh my gosh, what is this? And then very, very nonchalantly, he has a bunch of letters in his hand. It's as if he just called somebody to give the letters. He hands it over to me and continues the darshan.
Many of us go through a whole lifetime petitioning God to give us a sign. And you get these signs right and left.
I think that's the beauty of having an avatar, a guru. I was so touched by that one thing. And the way Swami did it so subtly. And God is so subtle. He called me, he knew this thought was going in my head, and this next second he calls me, he hands me over this and walks away. He doesn't tell, hey, you are thinking of me, I saw you. It's never spelled in black and white. And I think later on, many months later, I think in some other conversation, somebody asked Swami about experiences, and Swami, why is that the faith? Swami said, I give you experiences, but I give you the opportunity to develop faith. Because when you develop faith, you are building foundations for your own progress. So he gives us an opportunity, he gives us the experience we need, and then now it's up to us to say, hey, this was a coincidence, or this was a coincidence. Mm-hmm. And there was a sigh involved in this, there was an answer to my prayer. And that's my choice. So he leaves the ball in your court. I give you what you want, now it's up to you, take it or leave it. And ever since, there's so many of instances where where he gives you the experience we need, and then lets you decide. You decide now where you want to go with this. So the choice is ours. And this happens to me even today. In all our prayers are answered, then we wonder, was it just a chance? Was it just a coincidence? Is it truly God talking to me?
I think Leelas happen every day anymore in my life, because I see so many coincidences occur.
Exactly. Once you're in tune with God, it's amazing. And then once I got into Baba's room, it was a whole different
Sundaran,
series.
Sundaran, derelict in my responsibility by not asking you the most obvious question first. I believe you're the second person I've had the privilege to interview since Sai Baba's Mahasamadhi. How did the death of his form impact you? What do you make of it? Has it changed you?
It was hard. It was very, very hard to accept the fact that he was physically moving away from us. I was asked to speak to my college younger students over a conference call the day Swami was admitted to the hospital. And for some reason, I knew that he was not coming back, because the Swami I know would never go to a hospital, honestly. He would have stayed, and he has been sick before, he has gone with his darshans, he's never stopped away from what he was meant to do. The fact that he resigned to go, something told me that he's not coming back. And I broke down on that conference call. And that 1 month was very painful, because on the one side, you didn't want Swami to go through the pain or whatever he was going through. On the other side, you know, he was giving us time to prepare ourselves. So it was very hard for me to accept it. And I think the hardest was those 3 days when you actually saw his physical body lying still. It was something, you know, both of us were lying down at the laptop on our laps and watching the TV media, and it was horrible. I thought, for some reason, somewhere unknown, all the philosophy that I held suddenly got blown out of proportion, and just the pang of separation hit me hard, you know.
And why? Because you, among people I really respect, preach over and over again, Baba doesn't go anywhere.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't at all. But and that took me also by surprise. I said, where is this grief coming from? I thought I could handle this. I thought I could, you know, I had intellectually prepared myself. And I experienced Baba's divinity and the divinity within 24/7, as I do even today, and so does Maya. But then when this hit us suddenly, I said, this is the only guru I had, and he's no more.
What do you say when you utter those words? What do you mean that you don't have your guru anymore?
Well, physically. I mean, the fact that at the back of the mind, we always thought Swami was in Vrindavan, Swami was in Puttaparthi.
But you haven't been there to see him physically in
rules
of years.
Never, but just the fact that I've stayed there, we were always in touch with, you know, emails would come and you would read, okay, Swami's gone to Vrindavan, oh, Swami's visiting Bombay. You knew it was the back of your mind, there was a Swami there whom you could, if you wanted to write to, if you wanted to reach out, there was always a Swami there. And suddenly, the fact that he was no more hit you. But that's why I said it took me those 3 days where we cried shamelessly. I just let go. I didn't stop myself. And I know I sang a small song as a tribute, and I don't know how many times I had to retake it because I kept crying in the middle. But we did it simply because I had to find an outlet for my grief. And when the most painful was when I actually saw the samadhi taking place on the third day. And when I went to sleep that night, because it was late night for us when we were watching on our laptop. And when I went to sleep that night, I didn't know how I was going to get up the next morning. But then surprisingly, very surprisingly, I got up the next morning and there was no sign of grief. It just vanished along with that. It was more like a closure or whatever. I don't know what it is, but in my mind, I was back to exactly where I was. And I was so grateful. I got up in the morning thinking, I have to now go to work and things like that. I was preparing myself for the worst day ever, because now Swami Samadhi is over, and we had gone to bed crying. The next day morning was suddenly, oh my gosh, I'm back to exactly where I knew it. I was back to where I was.
Sundar, I've heard a little bit of this song. It's not fair. It's on short notice. Can you offer up a little of the song for us now, on command?
I will share with you the meaning first. And as I do that, at the back of my mind, I'll try and get the tune back into my memory. But the beauty of that song I love is the Allahi Rahim, Allahi Rahim, means God is merciful, God is kind, God is merciful. That's such a very beautiful mantra to even chant.
And what language was that?
That's Urdu and in Hindi.
Okay.
It's Hindi and Urdu, basically. Allahi Rahim, Maulahi Rahim. Mm-hmm. So that was the chant that it starts off with. But then the song goes like, you have strewn my path with love. so much love that just your gaze has lifted my life.
And how did that song come to you then?
This was a song, it's sung in one of the Hindi films, but the song, it was written, the lyrics are so beautiful, and even the context of the song was not out of the, you know, it's all about love.
But it just came to you, that particular beautiful song all about love just came to you after the announcement that he had left his body.
No, it was just around that time. I was actually thinking of this song, no, even before he had left his body, the song was, you know, I had come across this song and I said, I should offer the song to Swami. Everybody is praying for his recovery. I just want to offer the song of love. When masters like that decide on something, and I knew if Swami had decided on something, nothing is going to change that decision. I mean, you know, we could cling and pray to him forever, anything, but nothing would have changed that decision. And so I was contemplating on the song, and then when this happened that he passed away, then I said, this song has to be given to me. It was literally haunting me.
And has the tune now come to you?
Kaise Ishq? What is it? Kaise Ishq se saj gai rahe jab se dekhi hai tere nigahe ya khuda main to tera ho gaya. The moment I saw your eyes, I knew I became yours. It's a very touching song. It was very beautiful. And the way suddenly things started falling in place, I got the right pictures, the right, it just went on, and I kept crying throughout the song. And I enjoyed doing that and offering. I was very honored to do that offering.
I had a non-Baba devotee ask me what the loss was for me. And I said, I remember somebody telling me when my parents both died that we are orphaned. And even as adults, it's a strange concept, but yeah, truly we are orphaned. And I said, it's like losing my parents and my grandmother and my grandfather on the same day.
Wow.
Losing Baba has left me orphaned to that degree. And I'm sure if you talk to 10 people, it would be 10 ways of expressing a similar concept.
Yeah.
And for you, it was song that came.
It was a song. I think lose a relationship with a guru, a master and a disciple, is something so unique. I didn't realize the uniqueness of it till the separation was brought about. And reminded of a quote, a beautiful quote, which says, separation diminishes lesser affections and increases greater ones. This is not my quote, I'm quoting somebody else. Decreases lesser affections and increases later greater ones, like the wind that blows out the candle and yet fans a forest fire.
Wow.
So the lesser affections of darshans and sitting in the front of row, that is going to diminish now. But then the greater affection of what he stood for, how has he inspired me? What is now my, how is my life going to be a reflection of what he stood for? I think that is what is coming wave after wave, day after day. And I'm terrified at on the one side, but then the awakening is kind of just shot up in a far more greater intensity than it would have been otherwise. So ever since Swami passing away, it's like, what am I doing with my life now?
Well, you have duty for one thing. You have greater duty, greater responsibility to share. And that's what we're doing
here.
Yes,
that's why I'm very honored. And I really want to share my inspiration and faith, because this was a first-hand inspiration, a first-hand observation of who he was. It was just as any other youngster, with all his questions, with all his lack of faith, with all his curiosity and questions in his back of his mind, watching Swami. It's probably easier to convince an elderly person who's already got fixed ideas about God and divinity. But when a youngster walks in, you got to be on your toes. Now, when I deal with youngsters in the young adults, and I talk to them about Swami, I'm on my toes because I don't know what questions they're going to come up with. And I was like that when I went to Swami.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me to accept him, I want to tell people, hey, listen, if I can do it, you could do it. Because I actually saw a person in action who defies normal human logic. And I just want to, and the reason why I say that, it's just simple things. It's simple observing him in his room. You know, there's so much talk about, oh, Swami's room and this and that, and the media goes back and forth about his room. They don't have no clue what went on in that room, where he was just, if you and I get bored, we watch TV. If he would get bored, I thought he would call a Vedic pundit and engage in a conversation. you know. And that's all he did. He would say, okay, call this pundit. We would go running and call him. He would come and sit at Swami's feet. And then they would engage themselves in a highest philosophical conversations. It's amazing. And some of those conversations, I'm trying to dig into my memory, because I would be sitting out just outside the room on the steps, and I would go, wow.
Okay, work hard at digging up that memory, because we'd like to hear some of those stories.
Well, I guess it'll come. I guess I'll share some of those very beautiful teachings, powerful teachings of Swami. But then, talking of his personality, watching him inside his room, there were some funny and some not so funny incidents. One was where, you know, we talk of Swami being well and not well, and people wonder, why does he need a doctor, or why did he fall sick and this and that. Just like, you know, the question is, why did he have to read letters? He didn't have to, but he just did it just because he wanted to. One evening, Dr. Aldeja was sitting with Swami, and then Swami let out his hand, and then Dr. Aldeja was taking his blood pressure and feeling his pulse and talking to him, and I was standing a little outside the room, but I knew that he was doing this. And so I was very new to Swami then, and I was thinking...
And the year, more or less, for people's curiosity who want to know what era we're talking about here?
1980-81.
Okay.
That is when I was in Swami's Baba's room. So I'm standing outside his room, and I'm thinking, why does he need... If people out there are claiming he is God, he is incarnation, he is perfect body and this and that, why does he need to do this? Why is he getting his blood pressure checked? Shouldn't he know what his blood pressure is? I mean, that's a logical question that would arise in a 17, 18-year-old boy, right? And it passed my mind. I was thinking, and then Swami suddenly said, hey, and I peeked in, and he said, come here. And I went to him, and he says, this doctor is saying I'm having fever. You want to see? Is my body warm? And so he pulled up his sleeve and he let out his left arm. He says, just see, if this guy is saying I've got fever. And I went and I touched his wrist, and I almost recoiled my hand. I said, wow, Swami, yes, Swami, you have fever. I do? Yes, Swami, it's warm. Okay, come this side, see my right arm. So I'm crossing the chair, and because Aldeja is sitting right in front of Swami, so I'm crossing and walking over this side while I'm thinking, duh, doesn't somebody understand that the left and the right arm will be warm if you have fever? So I'm walking across, and I touched his right arm. And so cold. Now my hand doesn't recall. I'm just holding it. He asks, what is it? Do I have fever? I said, no, you don't have fever. Why? It's not warm anymore, Swami. And then he says, and of course, he's not laughing or anything. He's just saying, oh, what kind of education you people have? And one side you're saying I'm having fever, one side I'm saying I'm not having fever. Your education is all waste. So, and then of course Dr. Aldeja had a big laugh about it. And Swami was not laughing, he was just saying, see, all confusion, modern education is waste, and he just shooed me away. I walked out of the room thinking, okay, now I'm never going to have this question again. The idea is, what goes on in a body of a person who perceives life differently? I mean, what kind of hormones are secreted from our brain? I don't know. I mean, medical science think, you know, they put all those tubes and say, all right, if you're relaxed and this is, you know, dopamine is released and this is released and that is released. Hey, what about somebody who perceives himself as the universe? What kind of a brain, what kind of activity that must be going on in that body? For me, that one example was like, oh my gosh, who is this? Because I knew that one arm was warm and hot, and the other arm was absolutely normal.
A little bit, okay, go ahead.
There's one more instance, unless you have a question.
No.
So there is one afternoon where I'm getting all these letters piled up in trays because we had to organize them and take it upstairs to Swami, right? So I do all that, I come out, and then there's somebody waiting to see Swami. One of the pundits had come, and there was the Gita discourses were being given by this pundit every day in the bhajan hall in the afternoon. So before that, he would come and seek Swami's audience, sit with Swami, and they would engage in analyzing the Gita. It was a fascinating thing, listening to Swami. Swami would say, okay, what are you going to speak today? And he would say, Swami, I'm speaking on so-and-so chapter. What is that meaning of that chapter? And then the pundit would speak, and then Swami would give his perception. And you'll see the pundit going lower and lower, oh, Swami. And of course, he would come out and say, like, it's all his idea, of course. But then, so that afternoon, the pundit is waiting down for permission to come and seek audience with Swami. And so I open the door and I see the pundit and I tell him, wait, I'll go and let Swami know that you've come. So I go upstairs, and Swami's sitting in his chair. The room is about 12 or 15 feet in length. So I stand at the door, which we normally do, and then Swami says, "What?" So I tell him, "Swami, so-and-so has come." You know, in the normal tone of voice, which normally we would correspond, I mean, we would talk every day. Swami said, "What?" And so I took two steps in and I told him again, a little louder, "Swami, so-and-so has come." He said, "Bhojanam cheyaleda? Didn't you have food this morning? You had no breakfast? Can't you speak louder?" Now, Swami was serious. He was as if like, "I'm reading something. Can't you just speak louder?" So I spoke loudly. I said, "So-and-so has come. Come closer." So I took two more steps and two more steps. And finally, I was right up to where Swami is, literally into his ear, telling him, "So-and-so has come." Then he said, "Oh, okay, send him up." And I go out thinking, what was this? And this is not Swami smiling or trying to, you know, indicate I'm pulling your leg. Nothing. I was so terrified. I walked out thinking, what is this? Swami couldn't hear me. And so I sent the pandit up. And a little while later, another pandit came. And I had to go and tell Swami he had come. So now I'm going up. I knew the routine. I go stand near the door. He said, "What?" I started walking straight in. Swami said, "Stop." You just can't walk up to him. He says, "Stop." I was like, "Oh my God, the best stop sign ever." I was like, "Okay, Swami, what is it? Tell from there." And now I'm so scared because he said, "Stop," like this. So I'm literally whispering because, you know, you're afraid. "Swami, so-and-so has come." Swami said, "Yeah, I can hear. Go send him up." And I walk out thinking, who is this person? I mean, 5 minutes ago, he couldn't hear me. And now he's able to hear if I'm whispering across. And I remember a week later also, somebody was coughing downstairs when Swami was retired into his bedroom. He came later on, he said, "Who was coughing?" So, I mean, even if he wanted to hear, he could hear really well. And instances like those, you felt, who is this person? He's not doing it to impress you. He was not doing these things in front of cameras. Literally nobody was around. I mean, it was just him, me, nobody else, and some other. But here you find that he is either absorbed totally. He would sit sometimes just staring at a wall, doing nothing. He could be 45, 1 hour just staring at a wall.
Really?
Yeah, just staring at the clock or the wall like that. He wouldn't feel like reading the mail. And I'm talking, these are all in the 80s, where he would, you know, or engage himself in discussion. There were times he would call us to press his feet, and Swami would tell us, "Press my feet harder, harder, harder." And our arms or forearms, it's like, you know, milking cows. After a while, you just can't. Our arms would pain so much that we would actually be terrified to go and press Swami's feet. There were four of us, and we would fight as to who wouldn't go. We would say, "Okay, I've done my job yesterday, man, you go. I don't want to go there." Because we were terrified that we would sit, and it's not just pressing. He would say, "Aren't you eating food? Press harder." So you have to press those calf muscles so hard that in 5 minutes your arm is burning. He would say, "No more, otherwise get out." So you're literally, it was a hard workout. So you would, and there were sometimes he wouldn't allow you to even touch his feet. You'd just be very like, don't touch me, keep away from me, kind of a thing. And and those keep away from me movements were very stark. He wouldn't like you even if you come like 2 feet closer to him. Stay away, keep away, like, you know, it's like for your own good, I'm saying keep away, kind of a thing.
He must have terrified some of the young boys who had come up there and worked for him, such
yeah,
as yourself.
When you're actually doing it now, 20 years, 25 years down the line, I can sit back and relish those memories. But when you're there, you are waiting for the day to end because you are so stressed out. And you want to go back and just relax in the hostel.
You touched,
and just breathe a sigh of relief.
You've touched on this a little bit the last time we talked, but use your mental camera and re-rack the video a little bit to play back the description of his abode, of his room or rooms, and a few details. And I guess to set this up, I should remind you that when I once asked rhetorically, and Jody heard me say, "Why are we doing these interviews?" She said, "Because one day these will be super valuable. These are the disciples. And she meant then, I think, dozens of years down the road, long after Baba's physical form is gone. That time is now. And so to collect these stories, no matter how trivial or small
right.
the details are,
right.
they're going to be looked upon down the road with great interest even today they are. Right. Many of us didn't have that insight.
Right.
So if you will, set up the stage again of his room, rooms, easy chair, reclining chair, bed, desks, plural, one, how many lights did he have, et cetera, and so forth.
You know, his upstairs was, there was a room just above the interview room, which is pretty much the same size as the interview room. Mm-hmm. And there was one chair. In the interview room, there was one chair, and there was another chair. In India, you call a single chair as a sofa, but it's just one person can sit. It's not reclining. You don't, you know, it's not one of those reclining chairs where you can put your leg up and...
It's just a chair.
It's just a straightforward chair. And you had the waste paper basket next to him where you can tear the letters and dump, mm-hmm. which we would, you know, occasionally he would call us and we would clean it because it would get filled up so fast. And then on this side, there would be a desk, a small desk, where you would have these trays of envelopes, and that's all you would do, read. And in that, and the rest of the room was practically empty.
Did he have books or telephones or magazines?
No. It just letters most of the time.
I mean, these aren't.
There weren't any books that you would sit down and read. I would never seen him read.
How about newspapers?
Newspapers would come and it would lie on his desk.
How about television?
No, there was no television.
Radio.
There was no television, no radio.
No Netflix.
No, I remember. You mentioned television, and that reminds me of an incident. We went to Madras with Swami, three of us. We were doing a PhD, and Swami said, "Oh, you boys have been in the ashram. You don't know what the city is like. I'll come with you." This is what he was. I mean, this is one of the things I'm saying. Why would a person? Why would he love you so much? And we'll come across so much of his that impulsive love, spontaneity in his love. Oh, you're going to. He knew none of us had gone to our summer vacations to our home over the last 7, 8, or 9 years, and so now we are in our PhD. And then the registrar comes and says, "Swami, these boys need to do some actual research." Because those days you didn't have internet and Google, right? So you had to actually go to a bank or the Reserve Bank of India and meet people and go to the libraries. And our library was not that sophisticated at that time. So we had to go to Madras city and live there. And Swami said, "There's no way these boys are going out of the city. They have been in the ashram. They don't know anything about the city."
I'm sure that was true.
Which was true. There was no. We were out
Bangalore
of touch.
Bangalore is a big city with big ideas.
Bangalore and Madras. So when he said Madras, Swami said, "Okay, I'm coming to Madras. I'll take them with me." So that was good for us because we got to travel with Swami. Anyway, coming to this, that's when we went through the Anantapur campus. So, you know, we wouldn't look up at girls or anyone for that matter. And here's Swami taking us, and he's going to Madras via Anantapur. So he decides to stop in Anantapur. And we are, and three of us, and Swami told us, "I'm watching you." Now, the last thing we would be interested when you go with Swami is look at girls.
Well, no, you've got the school teacher, the school principal, and the assistant principal with you, and they've all got yardsticks.
But he is, you know, his attachment to us was so unique. So we were sitting for lunch and we were having food. You finish up on your plate because you don't want to waste food. Swami is sitting right there and watching. Don't waste food. He tells it loudly and clearly.
Are you
don't
talking
waste
about
food.
In his house, in the ashram,
in
or the, on
in the
road?
Anantapur campus.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
He walks with you to the canteen, to the cafeteria, to sit down to eat with you?
Yeah, on the way to Madras, he takes us to the Anantapur College, where it's all girls' college. Mm-hmm. So they invite Swami for lunch. So we are all in their hostel. In the ladies' hostel, just four of us guys, the one really close personal attendant to Swami, like Satyajit was in the last, you mm-hmm. know, there was Radha Krishna, and there was four of us, and rest were all women, all around. So we were literally, our eyes were on the ground, or looking at Swami, looking at the ground. And now we are sitting with our food in front, and Swami is sitting on the chair and saying, "I'm watching you, don't waste food." So when they serve you, you eat. And one of the boys, when they came, and they kept serving because we are Swami's guests, so they kept serving us. We couldn't eat after a point. So one of the boys said, "No, enough. Thank you." You know, he put his hand out. Oh my God, Swami was, "Oh, you're talking. What is this action to ladies you're doing? In front of me, if you're doing this, tomorrow you will do this." He was so angry. You couldn't tell Swami, how can I eat? No, you shouldn't say anything. So wow. You don't know where you want to be in this position. You would be like, "You know what, give me a break. I want to go back to hostel." Yeah. He was tough. And it was tough in a way that you cannot even explain to Swami I can't eat so much, and they're just going on, and I have to say enough.
Sure.
And if I say enough with
because
my hand,
because he's there, they're going to keep piling it up.
So
every
he
five
was
minutes.
So angry, and he wouldn't let go of that. 2 days later in Madras, he was telling the other girl, in front of me, he's showing signs to these girls like this. He was doing. I don't know what these guys are going to do behind my back. It was there was a sense of a naivety in Swami, a sense of childishness, you know. It wasn't as if he was, I don't know if he was pulling a leg or not, but it didn't seem that time. That time you were like, oh my gosh, what do I do? Where do I stand with this person? If I do this, it goes wrong. If I do this, it is wrong. So where do I stand? He kept us on our toes. So that made us really watch every single action of ours, every single word of ours, every single thought of ours. We were like alert. And I guess that was true training of living in the moment. Honestly, it was, you couldn't let go even for a second in his presence. So we are watching movies. You talked about television. So that night in Madras, he said, "Oh, let's watch some movies. These boys have come. They must be tired." So he said, "Watching movies, Swami, yay." So they bought a television set from somewhere, put it in there. And the movies he watched were three of them. They got the tapes. One was Ramakatha, Sampurna Ramayanam. It was a Telugu movie. They were all Telugu movies. There was a Shirdi Sai Baba Telugu movie. And there was Sakubai, a saint of Krishna. Her Telugu movie, because Anjali Devi, who was a very ardent devotee of Swami, who stayed next to Swami's house in Madras, she brought these, and Swami said, let's watch. And guess what? In like 30 minutes, we finished all the three films. Because you're watching Ramayana with Swami, and he watches, and that's a filmy version of Ramayana. So Rama, Sita leaves to the forest, and Rama is dejected, starts, and there's a sad song. Swami says, "Chee, Rama was never like that. Move fast forward. And then the dhobi guard, there is dhobis dancing. Chee, move fast forward.
That's
so
not
he
the way
kept
it was.
Fast forwarding everything except one song, Ye Nimishaniki, Ye Mi Jarguno. The song is very philosophical, and Swami used to ask the boys sing that song very often. He says, any moment, anything can happen. That's the song Krishna, Lakshmana is singing as he's taking Sita into the forest. So Swami liked that song, and that was the only song, because all the time you're suggesting a chariot going past, Swami listened to that one song, and then Swami said, "Okay, next movie."
It must have been very frustrating trying to watch those movies.
Like, "Oh, Swami, is this how you watch films?" And then the same speed, Shirdi Baba and everything went off so fast. He was like, "Oh, Shirdi Baba was never like this. Oh, Rama was never like this. What is this? This is all your stupid ideas. Come on, fast forward. So we finished it off in 30 minutes. So that's television and Swami. I don't think he had patience to watch anything. His concept of divinity was completely, completely unique. It was very real for him. Being divine was real. It was not like, not an intellectual, assumption.
Well, put it together. I'm just going to challenge you right now. Put it together, Sundar. You've seen this from 30 years ago. You've been thinking about it for, hundreds of months and weeks. You've watched him come and go as no mere human has ever had the privilege to do so. And these lessons have to be meaningful on a level are starting to make sense for you. I mean, on one hand, he's a tough as Dickens taskmaster. And on the other hand, he's asking you, while he's insisting on an impossible behavior, such as the food,
yes,
not gesture, what's the lesson? What's the takeaway now, this many decades later, that you can think of?
For me, it is the way I have made peace with this is the acceptance of the inexplicability of God.
Very good.
The acceptance of it. So you have the hot days, you have the cold days, you have the shower, suddenly a thunderstorm blasts through, your life might turn upside down. Can we accept it the way? And he was like that. If he was a miniature, and I believe he is the miniature replica of this cosmic thing that's happening, that was exactly what it was in his presence. Sometimes it'll be nice and warm sunshine, sometimes boom, a thunderstorm passes by, you wouldn't know where you're taking. It was constantly something new. And that is why I think we ended up staying there 15, 16 years, because every time there was something new to learn constantly. We were talking about this personality again. This is something people would have never watched. And this is something which only students and some of the students would have really seen in Swami. And I bring it out when I go to speak on retreats. Why I believe Swami was not human or normal, like you and me, was the dramas. He would love this place. He would love to come and see the rehearsals and the play.
And close to the end, there seemed to be dramas almost every other day.
Yes.
You weren't there, but the several times we were there of late.
Oh, yes, after that, so much has taken place. So many states and so many dramas. And he's a lover of fine arts. He loves all this. But what we noticed strange was, when he would come to watch our plays, he would become one with the actor on stage. So he would go through the same emotions that the actor is going through. And this is something so bizarre. It was like a five-year-old or a three-year-old watching a cartoon film. You know, if you watch his face instead of the film, you'll watch the film, the cat goes like this, the boy or the girl who's watching it, the kid will also do this, and he'll smile. Exactly what, you know, Swami would go through the same emotions. His eyes will go like this, he will become like this, he'll become one with that. Now here's a brief example of a drama we came up on the 60th birthday, and we wrote this. It was called Here and There. Here means Puttaparthi, and there is the outside world. So we are talking about a student in the drama, a student who learns the values and all that, and instead of practicing those values himself, he goes out to preach them, even before he is really imbibed them. So what happens is, when he goes back to his old friends, who drink and smoke and play cards, he would go to them and he would try to convince them what he learned, but then he ends up becoming one of them again. And of course, at the end of the play, he comes back to Swami's fold. So this is the whole drama. And Swami had heard the story before. Professor Gokak, there was then the Vice Chancellor, read it out to Swami, and Swami was very excited. And unfortunately or fortunately, I was one of the rogues. I had written the drama,
and I was one of those
guys who would smoke and drink and play cards. And there was one particular scene where this student of Swami is meeting these old friends, and then he's trying to tell them about the values he learned, and they just laugh it off. And in the end of the scene, they give him a glass of wine, and he doesn't have an answer. Now that entire scene, the first time we showed to Swami, he was watching it, and then he had the white handkerchief. You know, there's always handkerchiefs next to Swami's chair. So he pulled it, and he was twisting it and crushing it, and his face was becoming angry every time we rogues spoke to him. So we had glimpses of Swami doing this, and then later on, the other boys around Swami, they said, "Oh my gosh, Swami was so upset when you guys were doing it." Anyway, the scene got over. Swami quietly got up and walked away. He didn't say anything. So we were like, "Oh my gosh, what is this?" He didn't say good, bad, nothing. He was so upset, he got up and walked off. So we sent word saying, "What is this?" The next day he comes with more VIPs and says, "Rowdy scene, I want to see the rowdy scene." So he's now like a kid who wants to see that horror film but who's terrified. So he watches the rowdy scene, and again he goes through the same emotional trauma. And this time he got so angry, he got up in the middle of this rehearsal. He comes up right to this boy, this student who's acting, and he tells, "Why can't you speak to these old friends of yours? What have you learnt in Swami's college? Speak to them. Why are you allowing yourself to get spoiled?" And this boy was like, "Swami, this is drama. I'm supposed to act like this.
I'm doing the play within the play that you wrote, Swami."
No, and Swami walked away. And then again he comes the next rowdy scene. "I want to see the rowdy scene." He knew it was the play. He comes prepared for it, but in the play he gets caught into this, and of course later he mentioned to one of his senior devotees, he said, "See, for me, even in a play, I cannot see my education, my student going away, falling astray." I thought that was very unique.
Yeah.
For him, it meant it was real.
And he was speaking about you at the time. This is not as the actor. I mean, I thought he was playing the rowdy.
No, I was playing the rowdy, but he was talking to the boy who got spoiled in the drama. Anyway,
yes.
But the point is, even in the play, he said, "I cannot see my mission go astray," even in that sequence.
Mm-hmm.
But then, of course, when the birthday came, he still wanted the play. So he's now like a child. He has the President of India sitting next to him, and he's watching the rowdy scene. So now, but by this time, he's kind of seen it so many times, he kind of controlled himself, I guess, from emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So now he's watching the scene. Now he's telling the president, "Don't worry, this is only drama. This is not real. Oh, in the last scene, he's going to turn around. He's going to come back to Swami. Don't worry. And the president must have been thinking, "I'm not worried. This is a drama."
So
but for Swami,
curious.
It was like a child. He was telling people around him, "Oh, this is drama. They're just acting. They're not real rowdy. They're my students." And, you know, he was trying to protect us. because he was thinking everybody sees the world like he does, like a simple five-year-old thinking, oh my gosh, this is really happening kind of a thing. For us, that was so childish, so innocent, at the same time, very mysterious, because it is not like one of those chancellors of a university who wants a good drama put up, who comes and supervises, says, yeah, that's good, oh, yeah, make changes here and there, yeah, it's all fine, and walk away. This is a person who's sitting, who's becoming part of it, who feels the inner energy of the drama. You know, I acted as a pundit in a couple of dramas later. In one drama, he comes up to me on the backstage. He says, that's not, you know, I'm wearing a dhoti, you know, an Indian, the Indians wear what's called a dhoti. It's a white kind of a sheet that you, and the pundits wear it in a different style. And I'd worn it. And he comes up to me and I had a huge shawl covering it. So from an audience perspective, there is no way they would even make a slight difference in the way that dhoti was tied. Okay. He comes and he says, nah, there's something wrong. You don't have enough pleats on your dhoti. So he pulls it out and then he stands in front of me. Now he is creating the pleat with his own hand and tucking it back into my waist. Nah, now see, this is better. And so from 5 pleats, it became 7 pleats. That's all it is probably, or 8. He created more pleats in that dhoti. And I'm thinking, there is no significance of this from a drama point of view. But for Swami, a pundit, for him, that image has to be perfect. It's amazing how he would go into the depth of these details. You know, and there was another pandit role where I had to sing Harikatha. You know, there you have these pandits who go around singing God's songs. And so they have, I'll show it to you later, Swami gave me this. So they have what is called a different kind of a symbol, which is used in the 30s and 20s and earlier, you know. So they would use that as a symbol for the rhythm and for the sound to keep up with their singing. So I was just using my empty hand like this during the rehearsals. The day before the drama, he came and said, oh, you're using empty hand, you need something. Wait. So he goes upstairs and goes into one of his rooms where he has his treasures. He brings out his, and he said, I used to use this many years ago, keep it with you. And I'm that is one of my most honored and treasured possessions. And he gave it to me for the drama. And for somebody to do that for a play, I would think it was, for him, even the little things mattered. And for me, that was a sign of him being divine. I think, you know, in the Vedas, it is said, anoraniyan mahato mahiyan. That means God exists in the smallest of the small and the largest of the large. And for me here, the ability for him to pay attention to the smallest of the things and yet be the grandmaster overseeing a huge birthday celebrations and president's visit, and yet he doesn't lose sight of the little things. Oh, your pleats are not tucked in properly. Mm-hmm. I mean, where does one have the time for this? So many times I often catch myself, you know, I don't get time to take my dog for a little walk because I'm into a big project, and I say, Maya, can you help me out? I'm too tied up. But not with Swami. He wanted to be in every single, you know, part of the planning, because that for me, and that to me is a sign of something which normal human cannot do that. Not just once. I mean, at every single function, every single thing that happened in Puttaparthi, he was there. Even until as recent as 2 or 3 years ago, when the students were planning to go to Puttaparthi, he drove in his car to see where they would stay and personally see it. Because for him, he believed that if he looked at something, he would be blessing it. Mm-hmm. For him, he believed, and I say he believed or he knew simply because just different words, maybe he knew, I would say. He knew that his touch would heal somebody. He knew his word was important. He knew his look was important. So for him, he had to do it. You know, it was amazing how these little things touched me. On the one side is love. On the other side, how is it even humanly possible for somebody to keep track of all this? You know, what things which we wouldn't even consider as important, for him was very important. A day before his birthday, a real quick one, he comes for the drama, he sees our rehearsals, and I'm standing next to his car, hoping he would give me a last minute advice or something that he had to tell me just before getting, because the next day is the 22nd and we have the convocation and the drama. He's getting into the car and he notices I have a small hole here in my shirt. And then he says, hey, chi, you got a hole in your shirt. And he pokes his finger in and gets into the car. And I just smile sheepishly and I was just happy that Swami spoke to me. He gets into the car and goes away, and I didn't even think twice about it. Next day morning, 22nd, there's a convocation, you have president and all these people sitting in the front. And I'm not saying this to show that I'm important. I'm sharing this experience to see how Swami operates. So he's coming out for darshan. He has a brown envelope cover in his hand. He comes out, where is Iyer? And then I get up from somewhere at the back, and he says, he throws it to me. He says, there's a piece of shirt cloth. Goes get a new shirt stitched. I saw a hole in the shirt yesterday.
Wow.
So I was so stunned by that. And I often think back, and how did he remember to bring the shirt all the way down? Because I've been in Swami's room. I knew he would have picked it up, brought it all the way down. Why would he think of me? I mean, I'm not a VIP son. I'm just an accountant son. I'm nobody in that sense. And it wasn't that I was shirtless and I was starving on the streets. Just one single simple hole. But for Swami, if he sees something, he would have to immediately act, immediately. If you want to seek God, go within. If you go out to Google, you're only curious. And you know what curiosity does to the cat? It kills the cat. You're not going to find answers relating to God out in the media, out in books, out in different people. You could get inspiration from others, but you're going to finally find answers within. So when I was yearning for God, I would go cry out into the night, find an answer deep within.
Sundar, thank you very much. Sai Ram.
Thank you, Sai Ram.
To be continued. Allahi Rahim, Maulahi Rahim, 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 Allahi Rahim, Maulahi Rahim.
कैसे इश्क से सज गई राहें जब से देखी है तेरी निगाहें या खुदा मैं तो तेरा हो गया कैसे इश्क से सज गई राहें जब से देखी है तेरी निगाहें या खुदा मैं तो तेरा हो गया तू जो करम फरमाए अदम इंसान हो जाए मस्ताना हो के दीवाना हो के तुझे पल में पा जाए सांसे फिजा में तू है रूहे बया में तू है हर इंतहा में हर इंतहा में हर एक नजरे जबा तू है फिर ढूंढे क्यों तेरा पता तू है धूप में तू है साए में अपने में है तू पराए में अल्लाह अल्लाह मेरे रोम रोम की इक अदा तू इश्क मेरा है मेरे खुदा हर सांस में है बस तेरी दुआ तू इश्क मेरा है मेरे खुदा तुझे पाने से बढ़कर कुछ भी नहीं तुझे देखते ही दिल बोले यही अल्लाह राहें जब से देखी है तेरी निगाहें या खुदा मैं तो तेरा हो गया तू जो करम फरमाए अदम इंसान हो जाए मस्ताना हो के दीवाना हो के तुझे पल में पा जाए सांसे फिजा में तू है रूहे बया में तू है हर इंतहा में हर इम्तिहा में हर एक नजरे जबा तू